It gives me great pleasure to introduce my friend Sujata Parashar. Before I really start the session, I would just like to tell you a little bit about writing in India today. We are reading only two types of books. We are either reading bestsellers or prize winners. And the life that we lead belong to neither party. We do not read bestsellers, and nor do we want to read arcane rants about really, really vague things. And there is a whole battalion of us, to which Sujata and I belong, who write quiet stories, stories about real life, and stories that make an impact. And I'm really, really happy that I'm bringing to my friends in Bangalore, I'm a localite, somebody from Delhi who's doing something really, really wonderful. Apart from her writer avatar, Sujata is an activist. She does extremely powerful work in the social sector, and it reflects in the themes that she picks up. So I will just give Sujata 2 minutes to speak, and then I will start asking the questions.
Well, thank you so much, Nandita, for that lovely introduction. Hi, everyone. It's lovely to be here in Bangalore. I've come here before, but this is my first time at BLF, and it's the 7th edition I came to know. So I'm very excited and happy to be here and really looking forward to these 2 days here. About my work, she's already said, so I'll take less than a minute to finish my introduction. You've already done the job for me. Thank you so much. So you can carry on with the questions.
So I would like to ask you first, what has inspired you to write these powerful women characters? Who are the women from fiction that have inspired you?
Yeah, so just to go before that, you know, share a little bit about as a reader, when I was growing up, you know, I started reading very late in life. I was about 8 or 9 when I read my first book, and that was by Enid Blyton. It was called The Wishing Chair, I still remember. My focus used to be on stories. I wouldn't focus on characters or as such, you know. The focus was always on the stories, and that continued for a long time till I reached, I picked up Famous Five and Nancy Drew series. That is when the focus shifted to characters, from stories to characters, and I could relate to two of the characters from Famous Five. If you have read, I'm sure many of you must have read Famous Five, and the character Georgina was someone I could relate to. She was outgoing, she loved her dog very much, and she had a fiery temper, and all those things, you know, little things got me attracted to her. So after her, then I, of course, switched to Nancy Drew's again, same things. She loved swimming, she was multi-talented, etc., etc. So those things attracted me, and these two characters stayed with me for a long time. Somehow, over the years, of course, you know, I switched from all these series to other books, and I started reading crime thrillers and romance, of course. But there was nothing, I mean, I couldn't relate to the characters again for a very long time, until when I actually picked up this book, Madame Bovary by Flaubert. And somehow, Emma Bovary, the protagonist of that novel, she still stayed with me. She's still there with me. She's one of the characters that has stayed with me all through these years. So much so that I wrote a poetry, and it was published in my first poetry collection, That Classical Lady Called Madame Bovary. And in fact, my first novel, In Pursuit of Infidelity, which was published in 2009, the female protagonist has glimpses of her, which I did not realize then. It was it just came out unconsciously. Madame Bovary, this Emma character, was such that, you know, she was quite flawed. She had different views about, very highly romanticized views about the world, and she loved luxury. She married the doctor. In the book, her husband was a doctor. She married him just for money. And then she was disillusioned in the marriage, and she went on to have affairs, a couple of affairs, and actually she ruined her husband's life and her own life in a way. And the reason she attracted me was that there was this something odd about her which stood out, you know, and it I really don't know. I don't have an answer why she stayed with me all these years, but something about her being so flawed made her more human, made her more relatable. So she, that was one character. And then there was this another one, memoir by Elizabeth Gilbert, Eat, Pray and Love. And her story also, of course, affected me, impacted me in a way. So these are the two characters, you know, later on in my life, who've been there, even now, who are there with me.
So you've got the gist, right? We are talking about strong, flawed women and their lives and their destinies, maybe destiny, maybe the path they have taken. So these are actually the people you're writing about, flawed women, women who've had imperfect lives. And do you see a kind of a philosophy or a mission in the fact that you choose to write about women like this?
No, actually, I don't see any mission as such. I'm a chance writer. I was doing something completely different. And I was working in the social sector, you know, doing a project with women. And something about the conversation I had with these, you know, middle class women, there was this group of women who shared their stories with me. Something about them disturbed me enough to come back home and start writing a story. And I thought that this is going to be only for self-consumption or just to share with my friends. However, the plot started developing. Thankfully, I did not delete it. And I approached a few publishers, and Rupa was one of them. The story changed completely after that. You know, the first trigger was, of course, this thing, this conversation I had with these women. But when I came down and started writing, the Gapori in me, or the storyteller in me, probably, I did not even realize at that point in time, took over. And it went on a different storyline. It went on a different tangent altogether. But that was the trigger. Something disturbed me there. There was no mission, nothing. For all my books, the main focus always is to tell a good story. It's never a mission, or it's never a, you know, preachy, or I have to preach something or give a whatever, or, you know, sermon, etc. Nothing like that.
So, of course, now I will touch upon something that really interests me. And the topic is infidelity. And Sujata has a book. When did it come out?
2009.
So way back, about a decade ago, Sujata was thinking in terms of the Me Too movement now. And her book is called In Pursuit of Fidelity. And would you like to tell us a little bit about how the character of Sheena came about?
Yeah, so as I mentioned that, you know, there was no thought given to that character at that point in time. Now I give more focus when I'm developing my characters. But that point in time, I was just writing a story. And Sheena is someone who's who could be anyone, you know, a modern Indian woman, a new age Indian woman. She could be a housewife, a professional, or anyone amongst us who... Exactly like Madame Bovary, again, at that point in time, I wasn't thinking, but like her, she was disillusioned in her marriage. She was bored, she was neglected, and one thing that, you know, kind of led her to stray in her marriage was that she felt neglected, and she felt that she was being, you know, she wasn't being given that due attention by her husband, and she... wanted to express herself. She was very comfortable with her sexuality. She was a very successful woman. However, her husband, for some reason, he's a good husband, he's been depicted as a good husband, but for some reason, and his preoccupation with his work, he was neglecting his wife. She couldn't take that. I'm going to give away the story here. So the husband also has a one-night stand. So I felt that the focus should be on single conflict. Too many things would dilute the main idea or the main story. And that was also one of the other reasons when I decided to keep it that way.
So the next book, In Pursuit of a Lesser Offense, it talks about adultery. And what did you want to say through this book?
So actually the title gives it away, In Pursuit of a Lesser Offense. The first book was titled In Pursuit of Infidelity. But lesser offense. Now, what is the lesser offense here? My idea was, now at that point in time, again, the publisher wanted me to write a sequel to that, my first novel, because it did very well. So, but I didn't want to do that. So instead of focusing on infidelity or adultery, I changed the focus to marriage as such, and take a look at it. What are the reasons people get married for, and you know, are they the right reasons or not, etc. So, and through the narrative, what I have tried to show is that I think the greater offense is not getting married for the right reasons, or just simply getting married because the society wants it, your parents demand it from you, etc., and the, or as a second stage of love, whatever. So that becomes this marriage, which is flawed from the beginning, will have an impact on the relationship and may lead to infidelity. So in that sense, the title gives away the in pursuit of a lesser offense, and that's how I, you know.
And what did you want to portray through Sangeet's journey?
Well, again, I wanted to tell a simple story of a woman who's who's undergone a bad marriage, but her zest for life does not stop there. She picks on the threads and she moves on. And she again falls in love with another man. Of course, the man has to be is married at the again in the story. The second time she falls in love with a married man, and there's this conflict that I tried to show, because she's suffered that her husband, cheated on her, and now she's the one who's in that position, her husband's position. So what is the dilemmas and all that I tried to show in pursuit of lesser offense.
So this is the book that we are actually here for. It's Sujata's latest. The book is called The Temple Bar Woman. The title itself is intriguing, and the theme is rather explosive, and I will let Sujata tell you about it.
Well, again, before the theme, I want to tell you a little background about this book. You know, I started writing this book in 2011. And I sent it out to my publisher, my then publisher. And my publisher said, no, just don't do this. You have to create a certain image. So continue with your Pursuit series. You finish that and bring it out as your fourth or fifth book. Okay, so I dropped it. In 2012, the Nirbhaya incident happened in Delhi. I live in Delhi. And it shook everyone. It disturbed everyone around across the country. I, living in Delhi, I felt that, and I knew that I had started writing the story beforehand, and I thought that it is very, very important for me to bring it out at the right time. So now you all might have already guessed, this book is about a sexual violence survivor. It's a very Bollywoodish story, all my books are very, kind of
easy to translate to screen, so if you know any directors...
Please connect me to that person, to that director. Yeah, so the story is very Bollywoodish. It's a journey of a simple, educated, a simple teacher, village teacher, school teacher, who's brutalized and thrown into a brothel. She's kidnapped for a flimsy reason, gang raped and thrown into a brothel, and it's her journey from there on and what she does to avenge herself finally. So that's the whole thing, but the theme is that of a survivor's journey. So it's basically that.
One of the things I noticed when I was reading this book as opposed to her previous books is that the focus has shifted from the urban Indian woman and her angst to what happens in the rural areas. So was there a reason behind this?
Yes, there was. And it was very difficult for me to, kind of write this book. It took me 4 years to complete this. And I had to do a lot of research because this is not my area, as she mentioned. What happened in the Hyderabad Lit Fest way back, so one of the members from the audience, he asked me that you only focus on urban women. What about the rural women? And of course, I gave him my answer then that, because of my own background, it is easier for me to write those kind of stories. But later on, when I started developing the character, I felt that I must try, at least attempt to write a story, you know, and the character should be from a rural background, and that was the reason that I chose to do it that way.
So since we are talking about sexual violence and what women go through once they leave their home, particularly in places like the workplace or, you know, wherever they want, they have an ambition and want to follow it through, there are issues. And, you know, one of the things that I encounter when I talk about the Me Too movement with my friends is that most of them would say, oh, you know, women, those women, they have slept their way to the top. And 20 years later, when they have established themselves, then they are saying this. It's a very common narrative, you know. And then I have to keep saying that if she slept with her boss for a promotion, the problem is not hers, it's the boss's. The boss should not be stupid enough to give her a promotion based on that, right? But that is a moral issue. If she's sleeping with somebody like that for a particular aim, it's a moral issue, it's not a crime. The reverse is a crime. Because there is coercion, there is your status that you're bringing into it, the power that you have over your, you know, subordinate in the workplace, and that, in the, you know, under the Indian Penal Code, is a crime, right? And when I'm looking at this book that Sujata has talked about, she's talking about sexual violence within a brothel, sexual violence that sex workers go through. So we are already very, very confused. If a woman sleeps, then, you know, obviously the worst things can happen to her. And yet, it is a crime if, you know, she is violated in a way that she does not like, despite being a sex worker. And it's a very, very, very tricky issue to talk about, and you've taken that up too. So would you like to expand upon that?
Well, you know why I did that? Because I have worked in that area, and I have seen women, how helpless they are. And while my main focus was on this character, on the main character and her journey, I somehow wanted to talk about, you know, the sex workers and their issue and their struggle. It wasn't very easy for me because I knew nothing about it. I had to go and visit GT Road in Delhi, you know, the GTB Road, I think it's called, or GT Road. So I went there twice. And then I went to Singapore. There also, I went to that red light area. I'm forgetting the name, and I observed women there. And then I compared these two, sex workers in India and sex workers there, and their attitude and their behavior and everything. And it's so vastly different. There they are more free, more empowered. And here it is a pathetic situation. If you go and look at their living standards, and if you go and listen to their stories, it's horrible. And somehow I just wanted to bring their aspect weave it into the main story. And that's what I've tried to do.
So thank you so much. I think this brings us to the end of our session. And we have a little over 5 minutes. And we thought that instead of, taking questions from the audience, how about asking the audience for answers? The best answers will be given an autographed copy by Sujata,
yeah,
of her book. So the first question is, do you think, and we will take 3 answers, okay? Do you think adultery should be a criminal offense?
Can we pass around the mics?
Yeah.
Please. Somebody raise their...
We can hear you.
Can sometimes only be you going ahead and physically, separating yourself from a relationship, but you may still be emotionally connected to that person. And I think emotional fidelity is more important than
physical. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Any other answers?
Disbarred anyway. Haven't we had a recent judgment where the...
What is your opinion on that?
Okay, it shouldn't even enter the scene. The very fact that you speak of infidelity, I find that it's one-dimensional. Why does the term come into being? Why is it that a woman has to be wacky if she just sleeps outside? There are far many more dimensions to this. It's not sophisticated or deep enough.
So I would want to just add this, that the law that has come up, it does not say that there's a problem with the man sleeping outside of marriage. Adultery is when the wife has chosen to sleep with somebody and the husband brings the, say that my property has been violated by somebody else. So it was delinking, the law that has happened has delinked that aspect where the woman, the wife, is the property of the man. There's somebody there who wants to ask a question.
Oh, hi, my name is Koo and this is just my answer to the question. So in my opinion, I think deep inside, even after having developed as mankind, I think deep inside all of us run on caveman software. And no matter how many rules you bound upon us, no matter how close two people get, even if they get married into any law, even if marriage falls under a law, I don't think there's any foundation you can put on a person's emotional freedom. True. Or emotional attachment to anyone else other than their spouse. So it's I think as humans, we're free enough to do whatever we want. No one owns us. We aren't submissive to anyone.
Great.
Thank you.
I'll run to the next question because there's this actually is a countdown clock and I think it's going to explode if we run past it. Name three steps that can be easily followed to prevent sexual violence in India. Do you have any solutions against sexual violence in India?
Yes. Wing Commander Bhatt, now we all know that men flirt, right? That's at the educated classes. In the Air Force, we would say, okay, there's a target there. It's from the Battle of Britain. In the pubs, you know, when somebody goes to die next day, so he goes to the pub in the evening and somebody says bogey at 3 o'clock and somebody goes very nicely, politely and tries to get friendly. Now, the great thing about the armed forces is that we always respect the women. If she says no, piss off, and she won't say piss off, she'll very politely say, because this guy is polite, she'll go. But when we see cases like in Delhi, the nexus between the politicians, etc., there is a crying need, absolutely crying need, which nobody has addressed, is to start flirt schools for the uneducated. Those guys need to know. Let me tell you a simple thing. I went to this Marwadi bookshop and I was getting some binding stuff done and I casually asked that guy, listen, if you're in the bus stop and there's a nice girl sitting next to you, how are you going to approach her? And this guy was totally clueless. So I had to tell him, look, I had to educate him. I said, look, pal, it's very simple. You just say, I'm going to so-and-so place. Where are you going to? And then if she kind of responds, you take it to the next level. And if she finally says, piss off, piss off. But the bottom line is the woman is in charge.
Right.
That is the meaning of it. And that is why there's a crying need to start these flirt cool for the guys who don't understand it. Thank you.
Okay, the time clock is ticking, so I'll just run to my next question. What are the top two or three questions that couples should start out with before marriage? Do you think that people should figure out that this is the right guy, it's the right woman for me before marriage?
Two or three questions they should discuss among themselves before they decide to get married or get hooked.
It's all on here.
Hi, everybody. So, yeah, two to three questions. I mean, now I think millennials these days do want to get into a love marriage kind of a thing, but I think marriage is a totally other ball game altogether. I mean, even if you are partners for say 5 years or 10 years,
fast,
yeah. So Okay. So the first question really will be about freedom. I mean, I'll have my own circle, you will have your own circle, and they should not, you know, mingle together. The second thing would be definitely about profession. Like, I will not get into your profession, you will not get into mine. And the third thing, which I think is about finances. I will not interfere into your finances, and you should not into mine. So perfect. According to me, these are the three, you know, major things.
Perfect. I'm so sorry. This is going to explode in a minute, so we are running. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nandita. That was lovely. Very nicely done. Thank you, everyone.